Hey, welcome to, what is this, episode 5 of the Fruits Basket reading vlog series. I think it's episode 5, so I'm going to go with that. I have not been reading any more of Fruits Basket lately. I have been watching the anime though, both the reboot and the original version. I actually just watched an episode of the original one just because it's really weird because, like, my obsession with Fruits Basket has been reignited since watching the first episode of the remake, which I saw on Friday, and I did a whole reaction video to it, which I'll link on the screen and in the description box in case you want to see it. I flipped out a lot in that video, and ever since watching the first episode of the reboot, I've just been so obsessed with Fruits Basket lately. I don't know, I've been watching the original anime, reading the manga, looking up videos on YouTube of the series, of reviews. Like, this obsession is kind of cringy. It's kind of concerning me at this point. I don't know, I just love this series so much and I adore it. It is probably my favorite story of all time. It's just so good. So I do want to get back into reading the manga because I haven't picked up the manga in a few days. I did start volume 8. I read the first chapter, but I didn't get to finish it. So I have it right here. It's been sitting on my nightstand just waiting for me to pick it back up. So I'm going to do that probably tonight. I am still in a reading slump. And in fact, there's a readathon going on this week, which is Romanceopoly. And I have been really anticipating this readathon, but I just can't bring myself to pick up a novel. It just sucks because I was looking forward to this readathon, but I don't think I can participate because I don't feel like reading. I tried to pick up a book, an actual book, not a manga, last night, and I just could not get myself into the book. Like, my eyes were just glazing over the words, and it's really upsetting. But I have been getting more into reading manga again. I actually started Princess Jellyfish a few days ago, which is a manga. I started the first volume to that, and I started it because it's a manga pick for a manga club that I found on Goodreads that's hosted by, I think her channel name is Ashley Outpaged, and she's a booktuber and I really like her videos, so I really wanted to participate in her book club that's all about reading manga. I'm like, yeah, because I love reading manga, so I decided to pick up Princess Jellyfish since that's the manga pick for this month, and I really liked it. I want to continue on with that series for sure, but my main focus is on Fruits Basket, so I'm going to get back into this tonight, which should be really soon, and let's see if I can finish the whole volume tonight. We'll see. So I'll see you guys later. So it has been a few days since my last update, and I haven't picked up any more volumes in a while, but I did finish some volumes. I just didn't update on them for gosh knows why. I just forgot to vlog. Sometimes I forget I'm vlogging, and that is a problem. First of all, excuse how terrible I look right now, but it is nighttime, so I'm like in my ready for bed mode. So I'm not gonna look pretty. Anyway, I finished volume 8 and 9, so I have 2 volumes that I got out of the way. I just haven't updated on them yet. I loved volume 9, the last volume. Oh my gosh, it was so good. We're finally getting to the good stuff. The beach vacation arc has just been introduced, and I'm all for it. I love the part where the whole family goes on the beach vacation. So much drama happens during that vacation that it's insane, and I'm so ready to read it again. And I believe, last volume, Kirino was introduced, and I love him so much. I like forgot how much I love him. He is like an underrated character that is just He's so sweet and has such a sad story. You can tell he's so lonely, and I was like rooting for him and Uo to be together so much. So I am happy to be reading about him again. And Rin was also brought up briefly, but I believe she's going to be in volume 10 a lot more. So I am ready to get into volume 10 and pick up where it left off, the last volume left off. And I am going to do my discussion video for, I guess, both volumes 8 and 9 at the same time tomorrow, because I need to do my discussion on those. Those need to be done. Then after I do those two discussions, I'll probably wrap up this video. So that's just my quick update right now. I'm actually doing this update because I am actually going to go back into reading a volume. So I'm going to start volume 10 right now and read a little bit of it. While I haven't been vlogging, I've just been binge watching reaction videos to the new reboot of Fruits Basket. They're just so entertaining to watch. I love watching other people either fan over the series or newcomers to the series, like experiencing it for the first time. It's so fascinating. So I've just been binge watching reaction videos to Fruits Basket and making my own, which are uploaded right now. Those were super fun to make, and I'm definitely going to continue on them. Alright, now I'm just rambling at this point, so I'll go and I'll see you really soon. It is discussion time. This time I'm going to see if I can discuss both volumes 8 and 9 in one go. We'll see. I'm at least going to do volume 8, but if I feel up to it, I'll do volume 9. So that is the plan. I've been thinking lately, and I think I'm just going to start doing discussions on each volume only, because I'm not really vlogging a lot anyway in between, so I don't really see the point, and really vlogging is not necessary if I'm going to talk about the volumes anyway in a separate discussion. Why vlog? So that's what I'm going to do from now on. Anyway, let's just discuss volume 8. So in the beginning, Ritsu has been introduced in this volume, and oh boy, he is just a crazy character. There are so many crazy characters in this series, but he is one of the craziest. He has so many insecurities to the point where he can never stop apologizing, which comes off as so comedic, but yet is sad at the same time. It sucks that he feels like he's never good enough for anyone, to where he feels like he needs to apologize for just existing. Unfortunately, I think that is something that a lot of people can relate to. We often feel like we aren't good enough or we're a burden to people, when that's not the case. And that's how Ritsu is. And it all came from his backstory, to where his parents were always apologizing for him because he was part of the Zodiac. And that made Ritsu just feel guilty for being alive, for being putting this burden on people for him being born in a part of the Zodiac. And it's not that his parents didn't love him. I never got that vibe. In fact, his mom is the spa keeper, or the spa hostess, that we saw in the beginning of this series. And she mentioned that she does, like, love her son still. But Ritsu just still feels bad because he knows that he has put a lot of burden on her for being part of the Zodiac. So it's just a really sad story. And because of that, you can really understand why he feels guilty all the time and is constantly flipping out, thinking that he's always doing something wrong. And I like how his backstory gave a valid reason for that, because of course someone whose parents always apologize for you for existing, you're gonna be so insecure. So that insecurity is still with him today, and unfortunately it's caused him to have so low self-confidence that he wishes he wasn't even alive. And I found it interesting that when he dresses like a girl, that gives him more confidence, because he does dress like a girl. I don't think he's transgender, but he just likes to cross-dress, and that, like, gives him more confidence. Like, he feels more at ease when he cross-dresses. So that was kind of interesting about his character. I found it funny that Toru mistook him for an actual girl when they first met, and when she hugged him or bumped into him and he turned into a monkey, she was like so confused, because he wouldn't change by her touching him. If he was a girl, he has to be a boy. So that, like, took her off guard, and that was really funny. And of course, as Toru does with every person in this family, she comforts Ritsu, tells him that his life is worth living, that he does have something to live for, or he'll find someone or something to live for eventually, and she gives him that confidence. And then he says, I needed to hear those words again, which made me wonder who told that to him before Toru did. Maybe it was his parents, which would have been really sweet. So I like that she was able to comfort him. And then, I completely forgot about this, but there is some chemistry between him and Shigure's editor. I completely forgot that they were kind of a couple-ish. I can't remember if they were canon at the end of the series. I literally can't remember. I forgot that they were appearing at all. And they're like so cute because they're sort of the same person, because Shigure's editor is so frantic all the time. She doesn't apologize profusely as much as Ritsu does, but she's very spazzy, and so is Ritsu. So, like, I like that pairing a lot. I can't believe I forgot that they were a pairing, at least a pairing. Again, I don't know. I don't remember if they ever actually got together, but I don't know. But I'm intrigued to find out all over again. I love how so many of the Zodiac members share traits to the animal that they possess, because when Ritsu is on the roof and he falls, he like catches himself on the roof and like inhumanely pulls himself up just like a monkey would. And that happens with so many other of the Zodiac members in this family. They share so many characteristics with their animals. Like, Kyo is very skittish, and when he's around people, he, like, tenses up like a cat would. And Shigure is really overly friendly, just like a dog would be. So I like how so many of the members who are a part of the Zodiac really take on the characteristics of their animals. It's so cute. There's this part where Hattori is with Toru, and Toru has made him lunch, and Shigure comes in and is like, oh, would you like a housewife of your own? He's like teasing him about it, and Hattori is just like, you're so dumb, like, shut up. Like, there's no relationship with him and Toru like that at all. And then Kyo comes in and is so mad at Shigure for saying that and for doing that to Toru. I love how now at this point in the series, Kyo is always protecting Toru from Shigure's perverted remarks. Like, you can tell he is really starting to care for her, and I love it so much. And then the part where Ritsu comes into the kitchen and realizes that he took the last of the milk when Kyo was looking for the milk and there's no more, so Kyo is really upset, which is another thing that Kyo shares with a cat characteristic. He is always drinking milk, so that's kind of funny. And he like goes insane and just apologizes and starts throwing milk around. And I love how to calm him down, Shigure pokes him in the side and that like makes him faint. I don't know why that is, but for some reason he faints whenever he is poked, and that like eases the situation. This volume's saddest part probably is when the kids have an assignment to figure out what they want to do after high school, and Kyo is at a loss. He doesn't really know what he's going to do, because he mentions to Toru that because he's the cat, the family decides everything for him. So because of that, he doesn't know what his future is going to be like. He has no idea what he's going to do. And it just sucks that his future is so uncertain to him, because his family is the one that chooses how he is going to live. And he's not letting Toru know right now, but he knows where he's going to end up after high school, after he graduates. So that's why he knows he doesn't have a future. And Toru doesn't know that yet, and I'll mention that when it comes up, because we're not at that point right now. That aspect comes up way later, and it's super sad. And this volume ends on a light note, where Toru, Haru, Momiji, Yuki, and Kyo go into this haunted house, and that was a really fun time. Turns out Toru is very scared, but she like pushes on because she wants to like act brave, so she goes into the haunted house anyway, and is like scared of everything, which is so cute. She's like screaming at everything, and at one point she gets the idea that if she closes her eyes then she won't be as scared, but she just keeps bumping into things and the sounds keep scaring her, and which I find so relatable because I am a scaredy cat too. So Toru, I relate to you, and in fact she is braver than I could ever be, because I wouldn't even dare to go in there. I'd be so scared. And then to help her feel better, Haru makes up this story with one of the mannequins or machines that is pretty scary looking, and says that he had a mother who, like, abandoned him or something, and, like, gives him this whole sad backstory, and that kind of made her feel better and made her feel sorry for the animatronic instead of feeling scared of it. So that was super cute. And then Rin makes an appearance. Only briefly, though. This is the first time that she comes up. Haru talked about her. Was it in the beginning of this volume, or was it the last volume? I can't remember. Was it volume 9? Was it volume 7 where he, like, flipped out and I just, like, totally knocked those over? And, like, beat up the classroom? I, like, cannot remember. Let me check really quick. Oh, yeah, it was this volume. I completely skipped over it for some reason. How funny. So I'll mention it right now. At the beginning of the volume, Haru, like, destroyed a classroom because he went into Black Haru mode, and so Yuki, Kyo, Toru, and Momiji went into the classroom to try and calm down, see what was wrong, and then I think Yuki takes him aside, and he finds out why Haru lashed out and went all Black Haru mode is because Rin dumped him, and so he, like, flipped out because of that. So that's kind of the setup for their whole story, which I'm so excited to get into, which should be happening very soon because they're one of my favorite couples. And I think that is, yeah, that's it. That's where volume 8 ends. I love this one. Of course, give it 5 out of 5 stars. It was really good. And so now let's talk about volume 9 because I am in the mood for going on to this one, which this volume, oh boy, I loved so much. Just fix these really quickly so that my background doesn't look like total crap. And I'll put that right there. It'll stay. There we go. So this is the volume where Yuki meets the student council. So we're getting into that plot line right there. This is where it all starts, which the student council is brought up a lot in the remainder of the volumes. He meets Machi, and I'm so excited that she was introduced in this volume. When he first meets her, she has tore up the classroom, which we find out why a little later on, why she did that, and it's a pretty sad story where I really felt for her, but we will get into that a lot later. And then he meets the vice president, whose name escapes me. What is it? I cannot remember. Sometimes I think I do have to write down names that come across in the series, because there are some, like, minor characters' names that I don't remember. His name is Kikaru Manabe. Manabe. I'm just going to call him Kikaru. Now I remember. So he meets him and is instantly, like, put off by him because he's very eccentric. He is, like, loud, kind of annoying. He is kind of full of himself, all of those things, and that reminds him a lot of Ayami so much. There's one point where he's like, he reminds me of that guy, and is instantly like, oh, I don't like him at all. But thankfully, he ends up liking him at the end of the series, and they, like, become friends. So his hatred for him doesn't last long, but his first impression of Kikaru was not good. And then I love this part. Kirino and Uo meet, and Kirino's first appearance is in this volume, and I had forgotten how much I love him so much. He is so lovable, has so much love to give, and yet he keeps all that kind of suppressed, especially when he's around his family, and he rarely leaves the Soma house at all, but he does this one time, and that's when he meets Uo at her job at a convenience store, and after she meets him, she tells Hana and Toru about him, and tells Toru that he reminds her a lot of Toru because he's very clumsy, because the first time they met, they had bumped into each other, and to apologize, Kirino bowed, and the things he was holding just fell to the floor, and it instantly reminded Uo of Toru because she is clumsy like that too. And now that Uo mentions it, I do see similarities between them, because, yeah, I think Kirino can be a little clumsy based on that first meeting. And then after talking with Hana and Uo about it, she goes out and she bumps into Kirino again, which makes her so excited because she really wanted to see him again. And then Kirino brings up to Uo that he usually never goes out except for that one time. And Uo asks why, and he tells her that it's usually a waste of time. Like, he just doesn't see the point in going out. Which makes Uo so sad because that gives her the wrong idea that their meeting was like a waste of his time and he really wasn't into her, and she gets so upset and tells him that she couldn't get him off of her mind all this time, and she leaves while they're having lunch. And then Carino goes after her and tells her that she had been on his mind too. And I got so many feels from that, and like apologizes and everything, because then he said he really was glad that he met her. I love that part so much. And then afterwards, that's when it's revealed that he is part of the Soma family, and he goes to Akito, and Akito is super upset that he went out, and it's kind of hinted that something's going on between them. So that was a huge plot twist right there. I remember reading that for the first time, like, ooh, this just got so freaking juicy. And I think if I can remember correctly, Carino brought up to Uo that there's someone who he can't leave. I can't remember if that's later on or if it was in this volume. So you can tell I'm really getting my volumes mixed up this time around. But he eventually tells her that there's someone that I have to be with, and that is Akito, which he really wants to be with Uo. But Akito just keeps like a tight leash on him and hardly lets him leave the Soma house. He hardly lets him see the other members of the family, of the Zodiac. I can't remember why she keeps him all to herself. I cannot remember, and I'm kind of looking forward to finding out why he keeps Carino to himself all the time and is very like controlling over him, because I really cannot remember the reason why, and I'm kind of curious to know. We also get Hana's backstory in this volume, and it's so flippin' sad. Oh my gosh, I love Hana so much. She is a very interesting character. When she was in elementary school, she was still figuring out her powers. She knew she was psychic, and she didn't really know how to control it. She would hear voices all the time that she didn't want to hear, and her schoolmates thought like she was a witch or something like that, like she had dark magic. And so they egged her on to eat a bug because of that, and so they forced her to do it, and the boy who forced her to do it, she had wished for him to die, and he fainted after that. And that made Hana feel so bad, because she felt like she was the reason why he was put in the hospital. Fortunately, he didn't die, but she still felt super bad, and it was at that point that she knew she didn't know how to control her power. She was way too powerful. Her psychic abilities were too powerful for her at that time. There's also a point where I think it was in middle school, where the kids made her burn her arm. It's just, her backstory is so awful. I hate bullying so much, and in Hana's case, she went through extreme bullying, and the fact that she was able to hold it together all that time was really heartbreaking. And we do get glimpses of her to where she does break down, and if you know Hana, she is very stoic, and she comes off as so emotionless that seeing her cry and break down was so fascinating to me. And it just goes to show that she does have feelings, even though she comes across as emotionless. She really isn't. That's just her whole aura. That's just how she likes to come off across. But she does have true emotions. She just doesn't show them. And then the part where her little brother, Megumi, prays out loud for Hana to find a friend, to find someone who will accept her. That was so beautiful. Which leads me to the part where Hana first meets Toru and Uo in middle school. And Hana was instantly off-put by them befriending her, because no one ever wanted to be friends with her because everyone thought she was scary. And so when Toru is being so nice to her, she doesn't know what to do. And Uo is also being very kind and hospitable to her. And Hana tells them flat out, like, you guys don't want to be friends with me because I have a bad reputation and I am super dangerous. I can hurt people. I don't know how to control my power. All of that stuff. But they pursue and befriend her anyway. And then a rumor comes out around school that Hana wished for a boy to die, and that boy fainted and was hospitalized because of it. And so Toru and Uo now know that. And so Hana runs away, tries to push Toru away when she comes after her, and says that you guys can't be friends with me because I'm gonna hurt you. But Toru convinces her that she accepts her and that her past doesn't bother her. And then Lana just starts crying and she's so happy. And then that all ties back into how Megan Lee prayed for her to find a friend, to find someone who accepts her and loves her. And she did. And that person was Toru. Toru was just the instant solution to everyone's problems, which it's kind of convenient, but at the same time, that's just how Toru is. She is someone who helps people and knows how to help people feel better about themselves. So I don't mind that so much. I love that Toru is such a huge cure for members of the Soma family to help them feel better. And she also helped out her friend. It just goes along with her character, and I love that so much. One of my favorite parts in the manga was in this volume, and that is when Kyo takes Toru to Kazuma's house for lunch. That was just such a sweet part of the manga. When they get there, Kazuma is cooking, and Kazuma can't cook at all, and so he burns the food because he was reading one of Shigure's books while cooking. And so lunch is ruined and Kyo is like super mad about it. And what I find most funny is that he couldn't put Shigure's book down because he was into it so much, and then Kyo is like so annoyed because it's Shigure's book. And when Kazuma tells him that, he says burn it, like burn the book. I don't even know if Kyo's even ever read one of Shigure's books, but he does know that Shigure writes some romance. I don't know if it's smut or not, but he like writes romance books, so that might be why. And then Kyo kicks Kazuma out of the kitchen because he is like being useless because he can't cook. And Toru offers to cook them lunch, and so she does, and her and Kyo cook together, and that was such a cute scene. And the part where Kazuma's, I think it's one of his assistants, tells Toru that when Kyo was little, he was scared of a stain on the kitchen wall, and that embarrasses Kyo so much. And then Toru looks at the stain and she's like, it does look kind of scary. And she also says, I can see why you would be scared of it. And Kyo's like, I'm not scared of it anymore. Like, of course he's not, because he was a kid then. When you're a kid, you're scared of things that aren't even scary. I have been there. But then Kazuma has to leave because Kyo's father wanted to see him and talk about the plans to confine him after he graduates from high school. Which is where the part where Kyo's future comes up. He is going to be locked in a house, which is like called the cat house, for the rest of his life, which is just terrible. And like, his father is like desperate for him to be put in there as soon as possible, which his father just like gets on my nerves, because I can't even believe he hates Kyo that much to wish that he would be locked up right away. And of course Kazuma is so hesitant, saying like, I don't want him to be locked up, he is willing to fight for him. And that gets Kyo's father very upset, and he goes off telling him that Kyo is the reason that his wife died, that he brought shame onto their family. And yet Kazuma's like, no, that is some bull crap right there. And I love him so much for that. Like, he really knows that Kyo is not what the whole family says he is. What the family says he is just based on the legend of the Zodiac, and because Kyo is the cat, he is an outsider. They all see him as an outsider because of the folktale, but Kazuma sees him as a real person outside of the curse, which I love him for that. And I love that he is willing to fight for him and also puts Kyo's father in his place, because that guy is just one of the villains of this story that I absolutely despise. Then at the last page, it is revealed that Yuki is the one who gave Toru the hat. Which, because of the foreshadowing that happened earlier, it's kind of obvious that he was the one who gave her the hat. So that is finally revealed. I love how much the hat is coming up in the anime reboot. It is coming up so much. So there's a lot of foreshadowing happening in the new anime too, and I love that. And I'm looking forward to getting into the part in the manga where we go into more of the backstory on the hat and how Yuki met Toru before they met as teenagers, and Toru doesn't even know it. So that is where that volume leaves off, and this is also where I'm going to end this vlog. So I hope you guys enjoyed the vlog. This will be, again, the last reading vlog for the Fruits Basket series. I'm just going to do discussions on the volumes from now on. I'll probably discuss two volumes her episode, so those will be coming out very soon. And I hope you liked it. And if you did, be sure to like, comment, and subscribe down below for more bookish related videos. I post 2 to 3 times a week, and I'll be back really soon. Bye.